Sure thing.
Let's say you should do something.
Do your thing.
Okay, so we are actually part of, we're students, the three of us. I'm Nandita, this is Rhea, this is Jones. Okay, we're part of Shishti. It's a college for design in Yelahanka. And we're going to talk to you mainly about street art and how it's right now really catching on in India. Earlier wasn't, now it is. So we're part of this group called the Rabbit Hole Radical, which was actually the name of a course from college. But it was about how street art influences society right now, how it's catching on, how do you do it, and how do you not do it. So street art basically is any form of communication by an artist or any person to the general public. And why exactly would you choose street art for this whole thing? The point of this is so that it's free. You don't need to really say, I need a gallery, I'm going to go pay for this, beg them to put my work up. No, you don't need any of that. Right now, it could be in any form. So you could just, in our case, we asked for a wall. We approached a person, we asked for their wall, and we said, hey, can we paint it? And depending on the response, voila, street art. You've started. So
I mean, when it comes to street art, the thing is, when you're actually painting over there, you have maximum connection with the public in itself. Because when you're in a gallery, you're curating your artwork and everything, and you've got people coming in and questioning you about your art. It's not the same as when you're on the road and you're painting and you have people approaching you. People of all ages. You've got little kids approaching. You've got men and women. They're all coming and asking you what you're painting, what your concept is. It's a completely different situation altogether, because it's the common public and they're curious about what you're doing, and you're attracting them because you're there and you're painting a huge thing, a huge mural, and they want to know what you're doing, and you're connecting with them for that minimum amount of time. So, and necessarily street art does not only mean mural painting. It includes magazines. Posters.
Seeds, posters, magazines. This could be in the form of installations. It could be ethical or unethical. It could also, you could be doing advertisements, you could be doing fake advertisements, that is advertisements for things that actually don't exist, just to like make people curious, so they know you're out there and they know you're a weirdo trying to put your work out. It could also be in the form of, it could be anything, it could be a painting.
It could be, see, we had this
poetry.
Project, one of our projects, yeah, poetry. One of our projects was creating totem poles out of the telephone poles that exist in Yelahanka. What we did was we took all the totem poles in the area, this was Jones's work, and we taped designs on top of them. So we turned them into totem poles. That's a form of street art. We've got fake posters. We've got maps to fake murals in the area. We've got maps to real murals in the area. And mapping actually is a huge part of our process, in sense that we used mapping, like, how do, for example, one form of mapping was find 12 places in the area, write stories about them, and turn your stories into mural pieces, which will then be put in different parts of the entire locality, which would
see, eventually,
be put in the magazine. Yeah.
The point of that is, when you have like a map, first off, the people.
Sorry? We photographs, yeah, but we have no
projector. Yeah, there's no projector, so we didn't prepare any of that.
Links, so
if you're interested, you can check them out later. We have pages for most
we
of this.
We have a Facebook page. 30 for murals and a few posters, yeah.
Yeah. So basically the point, we went through a whole procedure because it was a course. I mean, you had students outside of this course who were interested in it who said, okay, we're going to sign up for this because it exists and we want to try it and possibly learn more about it. So we went through a whole process of a whole bunch of intricate drawings and figuring out what you're doing there and what you could be doing. And then we figured that most of us were really good at mapping. And we figured we could actually put this in to a way of making murals out of it.
Mapping is actually mapping, yeah.
Okay, you got a place, figure out you want to put your work out there. But let's say if we take a place like MG Road, it's a pretty big place. And like, mapping is, I get, for me, I feel it's more important when it comes to guerrilla street art that is not with permission. You need to know exactly where you're going to put it, and go put it. You don't have time to like, okay, that's a nice wall, I'll do it over there. You don't have time to do that. So you need to know which walls you're going to work on before and work on it. So mapping we used, because we also made a publication, and this publication had information on where all our works were. So we pretty much mapped the whole area, like, and like identified our works on the map and gave it out with the morning newspapers.
We were to map all the newspaper routes in the area, and because of that, we had to contact the newspaper boys in the morning, and we had to give them all our publications. We had not one publication, we had three publications, out of which two were comic books, which we'd created based on the fantasy stories that were created. And so we all these publications were put in the newspaper. We had about 4,000 to 5,000 copies, which we circulated in the entire area, which is another form of street art, where we're reaching out to the public, right? So street art, in essence, is just about connection with the public and about expression without having restrictions, if you get what I mean. So
I mean, right now we've just been like giving you really vague details about what our course was and what street art is, but I'm going to talk about what exactly this whole course was to us. So we had a particular teacher who brought us all together and said, I don't know who you guys are and I don't know what you're doing, so show me what you do. So we went through 10, 15, 20, sometimes 40 drafts of different types of works we were capable of, which is, I'd say, the most basic steps in this whole process of being a street artist. You need to know what your work is, why do you want it out there, who do you want seeing it, where it has to be, and whether it has this fixed style, whether you're okay with the style changing. We needed to know all of this.
Whether you're okay with collaborating with another person, whether you're fine with working individually, whether your style meshes with someone else's. It all came out with these 40, 50 drawings that were created in the first week of our course. And then what followed was us cementing our styles and techniques down. Because when you want to create a technique, you want to create a mural, you can't be unsure about what you want to do. So we were putting down exactly what we wanted to do. We were cementing it down, and then we took that forward and we created a piece we wanted to put on a wall, and we wanted others to see on a wall. And that is how our entire process began. And then after this, we followed through with mapping, and then we went through with our murals.
But the point is, when you're going through with your murals, it's not just about the picture you've drawn. You might have drawn this whole picture, but how possible is it to actually put it on that wall? How big is your wall? Do you have the material to do it? Do you have the capacity within yourself to put it out there? We had to go through all of that, and we had some of them say, these two were working on this particular lane that had really huge, very nice walls, but the lane had severely negative connotations because it was this isolated lane.
It was called Rapist Lane, yes. Essentially.
It was called Rapist Lane, and it's we don't know the real name. Nobody knows the real name in the area. Everybody just calls it Rapist Lane. It's especially called Rapist Lane in our college itself because there were rumors.
Lots of rumors. There were lots of occurrences that have actually happened. It's in background. It's in Yelahanka.
It's in Yelahanka. And see, the thing is, we took it as a social cause. And we were like, we don't want it to be Rapist Lane. Because there have been no accounts of rape in the area. They're just rumors. Because there's a construction site right opposite that lane. So, I mean, it's crawling with men and all kinds of, I don't know, all kinds of crap. I don't even. So, it's like, we took that entire stretch of wall, okay?
We didn't paint the entire wall, of course.
We were like, and took the wall.
Yeah, that was a big thing. I mean, permission's a fun thing.
Okay, we'll get to that later. But then they kind of use that whole area, and the wall, I'm talking about how it's not easy. Even though you might have the permission, it's not easy to work on the surface. It was this terribly porous brick wall that would swallow your paint. Then you have other factors to work with, like, my wall is 10 feet high in the air. How do I get there? So we had some of us running around trying to search for ladders and stools and any form of getting up there to finish it. You had other kids who'd said, can I paint on the road? Will that be a possibility? And you had all of these weird things coming up.
Installation. That was so cool. What this girl Karthika did, she cellophane, and this entire stretch of cellophane, and she painted and she layered that cellophane and she stretched it along two poles in the area. So it was a mural piece, but it wasn't. It was like a detachable mural piece that you could, if people didn't like it, you could just take it out and put it somewhere else. But the problem was it got stolen the next day. So, yeah, that was unfortunate. Yeah. Yes.
And that's basically like the final part of this whole process. But within this process of putting it out there, you have the whole dealing with the public, communicating with people. People are going to always come up to you and say, what are you putting out there? Why are you defacing somebody's wall?
You have a lot.
They will ask you your purpose and what you're trying to communicate. They will always think it's about religion. They will always think it is about caste or gender discrimination. They will never think that it's just a piece of artwork or a piece of expression that you just want to put out there. They will always find a meaning within that.
They judge and you before you can tell them what it is.
How so? I wanted to ask you since you brought it up. So, other than the mere pleasure of
putting it out there,
working on it, other than just the mere pleasure of is there another meaning that you have underneath?
Depends from person to person. Suppose I want to...
Why do you do this?
Yeah. Well, the general reason would be it's fun.
Right.
Well, that's the main reason. But if you want to put a meaning to it, like which is relating to some social cause, you can. It's your choice.
See, the thing is not just about fun. It's also because street art isn't as... I mean, it's catching on right now, but it isn't as...
Popular.
Isn't as well known as it ought to be. And the thing is, we like street art as a form of communication. We find street art very, very intriguing as a form of communication, and we wanted to explore that. So we were just trying to, other than just painting, which everybody enjoys, we were trying to connect with the public.
It's
because
a good way to put yourself out there without stereotypical money, economic-related sources.
And the thing is, Srishti in Yelahanka isn't very welcome because Yelahanka is like a very closed locality and Srishti is like an unwelcome weed in the area. So we were basically communicating with people we hadn't interacted with in forever. So it was a different experience altogether because we were actually connecting with the locals and the locals aren't quite fond of us.
And actually, I'd say after this, they kind of accepted us just a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, we are all outsiders. Like, there was this incident. One of the people in the rabbit hole radical wanted to paint on a water tank. We got permission for the tank. And this lady had come to us and was like, all you people, you're not from our city. You are working here. We have incidences like that. We are all considered outsiders since we are not originally from Bangalore.
I mean, it's about...
It's a very closed society as opposed to what we have a picture of Bangalore.
See, we're generally not welcome on the streets. You get the stares, you get the unwelcome looks and all of that.
See, the thing is, we don't even live in a hostel. We live in paying guest facilities scattered throughout the area. So we're mixing with the residents and with the locals. So, well, the people get annoyed with us quite often. That's a nice way of putting it.
We're going pretty off topic. But the thing is, they have reason not to like us, which... A lot of people, even students who are living there, don't seem to understand. It can be controlled.
But then again, when that's an image I thought I had before I started working. Like, when I started working on my wall, which was on Rapist Lane, it was a different experience completely. Because we had there's a garbage dump next to the road, and we had these rag pickers coming and giving us suggestions like, no, your mural is not good. You should draw a cow eating trash. We had like very interesting suggestions, and by the end of the day, we became quite friendly with the rag pickers there. So, it's a like the communication with the public while working.
You're doing something for the area. Like you said, people look at you in a negative
light.
Yeah.
You can try cleaning up the locality. You know, earn there.
It's been done.
Yeah, we
it's
have.
Been done.
We've
but
tried
then,
a lot. No, Srishti is open to the locals 24/7, and we've got exhibitions.
We invite them and we put posters around saying please come. And like when we had this whole street art thing going on over there, it was for a period of a couple of months. We were actually talking to people from those houses, the people we'd ask for permission. You'd have their neighbors come out and say, Ma, why do you put this big thing on this wall? And they start accepting you just a little bit, but I think the ones who really don't want to accept you probably
it's
just
more of a cultural issue,
yeah. It's a cultural issue.
It's also
about something new and
yeah.
unseen.
and they don't quite. They're a very close community, and they don't look. But this is off topic.
Yes.
Yeah, this is very off topic.
Yes.
So if the locals are feeling your arts to be quite weird, right?
Yeah.
So have you made any attempt to understand what the what are the types of art that they would like to connect with?
Well,
probably that will help you.
But the thing is, when we put something out somewhere, it's more for our own pleasure than for others. But when we work on someone's wall, like this is something a street artist from Pune said, I guess. What he said was, when you ask for a wall, you get permission for a wall and you're working on it, there's a small give and take over there. So they give you a place to paint on and you give them something like they like on the wall. So as far as what people like, I guess, it's just towards what the owner of the wall likes, who owns the canvas, and what the artist likes.
See,
that's what I feel.
When we come to painting what we paint, we don't want to offend people. We have rules. And we don't want to offend anybody in anything we paint. We don't like religious connotations. We don't like...
No advertisement.
Nothing.
Nothing about current topics, no controversies. This is like if you're starting out, you would not dare make an attempt on any of this. Because they're going... You could, but you'd get really, really messy. So, I mean, we have a lot of ethics over the whole thing. So, for one, you'd have to ask for permission. If you're doing a big mural and you live in that locality or it means anything to you and you actually want to get known as a person or a figure that's likable, you ask for permission.
Or if you look at the illegal ones, which no, like, there's no people, no, I mean, like, the illegal ones which are done without permission.
Graffiti.
Most street artists in India, at least, stick to the walls which are, like, neglected, the walls which people pee on, the walls which
are... People leave their pan on, leave the dump, the garbage.
So most street artists do mostly work on those walls. But they do go to other walls. I'm talking about the more established names. They do work only on those. But they do, use the other ones, but less often. I mean, sometimes you do break rules. I mean,
yeah.
Graffiti is an illegal form.
Graffiti is like saying street art, but illegal.
See, graffiti is a form of protest against something that's happening. It could be against the government, it could be against an issue, but it is a form of protest.
For example, in Britain, graffiti and street art is completely... Graffiti is removed, it is whitewashed, it is removed. While street art, they have some... The police have some way of, like, classifying graffiti and street art. So, street art, if they think it's street art, it stays on the walls, while if it's graffiti, it's out of the walls. For today, graffiti is something... Yeah.
When you censor graffiti, it gets street art.
You don't censor.
Not exactly censor. Actually, I think that's a way of putting it.
See, graffiti, the difference between graffiti and street art
it is
the motive in the first place, right?
Like, for example, graffiti, at least most of the time when we talk about graffiti, it's only... It's called a tag, basically. A tag is when you put your name on a wall. You can just write, like, your name. It's still graffiti. So those are not necessarily visually appealing. It's just publicizing yourself.
It's not even publicizing yourself.
It's like when you see Tanu likes Manu on the... Yeah. It's that's graffiti.
And
except they use spray paints or markers.
Yeah, and I mean, see, when I say it's the motive in the first place, street art doesn't necessarily protest anything. Street art is a form of expression. It could protest something, but it's protested legally. And... Graffiti, on the other hand, it's like a form of rebellion. Graffiti was a huge movement.
Yeah.
And it was a form of rebellion against the government.
In various countries, it's always... I mean, smaller ways of rebelling against an unsatisfactory authority was graffiti.
If you're not
graffiti.
Happy with something, you use graffiti. Because that is something you...
Nobody knows who
away.
You are or where you're from. All they know is next morning there's something big on that wall.
And
there.
The anonymity is what...
makes it so possible and doable.
So
that's why graffiti.
Pardon?
Yeah, that too.
So graffiti also is about reaching out to the audience, right? So if you want to do graffiti, you obviously have that motive in mind that you want people to know what you're thinking and you want people to know that you're protesting this. So obviously you can do that through the internet as well, but the monumentality that accompanies graffiti is not something you'd find in a comment on a post on a...
See, because now graffiti and street art actually are things that are unavoidable. If I'm walking out of my house and I have a big cat on the wall, I have to see it every day without fail. Whether it's graffiti or street art, that image is going to be in my head. So, there... No, that again depends on society. Now, if you're not willing, if you're not accepting the whole artsy outlook on the whole thing, or freedom of expression or whatever that is, you would not really like it. But if it's a pretty picture and it's doing you no harm, why not? Right? That's different ways of looking at it. But if it's on my wall and I live in that house and I did not give you permission to do that and it's on my wall, I'm bound to get angry. So there are different sides looking at the same
situation.
Picture of situation. Yeah. Yeah.
As a project.
It's actually quite possible.
How do you make?
See, we
at the end of the day, you have to make money.
We started out as a course, but then we started building up our base. We've got a Facebook page, we've got email, we've got all that stuff. We've not got a Twitter yet, but we probably will pretty soon. And we do reach out to people sometimes. I mean, and people reach out to us. See, we got offers as soon as we put up our work online and we publicized it. We majorly publicized our work. We sent shares, we sent invites, we sent everywhere. And all our zines, the 4,000 copies, the 4,000 to 5,000 copies that were sent out in our newspapers, in that the next day, everything had our addresses to our Facebook pages. And so we did have a major hand in getting people to come to us. And so that obviously, that resulted in one or two offers.
Yeah.
And so
what kind of offers? What kind of projects did you get?
See, from what they saw from the page, they saw that it's a bunch of people painting appealing pictures, right? So we got offers from some pretty big companies saying, can you come help us do up our place, our facade, things like that. And we got a couple of offers. We got the offer to come talk here. We've had people just randomly comment and say, hey, that is nice work. If I need help, can I contact you? So there's a lot.
So we've got... See, the thing is, we're still very... we're like a newborn baby in our sense. Yeah.
Right now,
so we still...
Do you have a vision in mind?
We probably want to become a proper, legit street artist organization sort of thing.
Yeah, that would be nice. Because, I mean not as all to of how us you things. Earn money, there are different ways of doing that. Because, for one, you could put your work out there. Okay, you could get extremely popular if your work is good enough, if the society thinks your work is nice enough or talks enough about things that are worth listening to. Then you've got your name. And from your name, people attempt to contact you. You make yourself just about available. And once that happens, you get offers for a large span of things. It could just be painting. It could be being the face of something. You could be working behind the scenes for a lot of things. Like, you could be doing interiors, you could be doing their... See, if you're an artist, you obviously have other skill in your hand, except just painting. So you could be the reason for somebody else's publicity, or the reason...
People will come to you for your skill set.
Yeah.
They might just know about your painting, they might just know about your murals, and they might just know about your organization. But because we're not just street artists, we are...
We're artists on the whole. We're artists and designers. So they're bound to know your background as well.
So they will... I mean, we don't necessarily want to limit ourselves to street art.
Yeah.
We are street art.
That would be like a passion or a way of expression.
So, since you when you were in school, so what did you have in mind when you had to choose your college or course?
Right.
And let me take this big question. So, you've chosen this course as a main... as a means of taking your career forward or whatever.
Yes.
So, and like in the previous session, the general mindset in India is to, your kid is going to become a doctor or an engineer or a lawyer or whatever. just those are the mainstream. If you have to encourage kids of the next generation to take up art as a form of career, what would your advice be? And what would your advice be to the parents to convince them to take up art, to convince them to make their kids take art?
I think art nowadays has a huge scope. Like, since you're talking about street art, and when we think about like career choices, we look mostly into like when, like, the amount of income you're gonna get. That's the most important part. So like, let's talk about street art. Like, for a well-known street artist, not a well-known, like a street artist who publicizes himself as a street artist alone. Per project, the minimum wage, like, let's say a wall which is the size of that whole area, the pavilion.
The whole pavilion up there.
Yeah. So maybe that big a wall would get a street artist minimum wages around
$1,50,000.
$1,50,000
if you're like just starting out, but if you're really big and well known, they're willing to pay you like a lot more.
And a wall that big would take 2 days.
That's it. That's 2 days of your time, and you
but
have a masterpiece.
Yeah, but that's not a recurring income, right? So you might get it. Say this month you get 2 projects. Next month you don't get anything. That is a risk.
See, that
yeah.
Is
yeah.
Right. Yeah.
You go freelance, it's in everything.
Right.
Yeah.
So, what do you? What is your? What will be your argument to the parent?
See, the thing is.
Well, if you become an engineer, like, there's
so
there
no... There is a guarantee that I'll get a salary next month.
Yeah, you'll get a salary, but how much of a salary do you get?
As long as
it's... How much of a salary?
I'm freelancing for past 4 months. So I just go 2 projects in 4 months, just earning 20,000 in 4 months.
Right.
So it's not a guarantee. But I'm an engineer myself, right? So, similar thing. Right? I'm freelancing now.
I mean, just because
you can go for a job as well, right?
You get a good amount unless you're good. So there's no security in that job either. Unless you can actually put yourself very high. And the number of people who are studying engineering now is going to be, it's a lot more competition than design, for one thing.
And design has a lot more, it's like, it's a lot more flexible, because in the sense that, especially in Srishti, we have so much scope. It's like, we don't necessarily have 4 streams. We don't necessarily have textile, film, interiors. We don't and visual communication product. We don't have 4 streams. We have this entire wardrobe, and we could just mix and match clothing, like, if you get what I mean. So, and the thing is, we as designers, we get to.
We don't need to be limited to a particular stream.
Yeah.
So, like me, for example, when I got the idea of design from my mom in 5th grade, because she mentioned it fleetingly, saying, oh, you're a good artist, you should do design. Ever since 5th grade, I've been brilliantly fixed on it, and I landed up here. So now that when I walked in, I said, I had this checklist over here saying, we see furniture, interiors, a whole bunch of things.
Yeah.
I was like, I don't even know what I want to do. I just want to design. I want to make things. So
and
I randomly ticked off a couple of things. But once in, I figured that I don't really have to worry about this, because I have this one course there on furniture. The other one offers me textile. This one offers me VC. By 2nd year, you're pretty sure, saying, I enjoy this more, so I'm bound to do better at it. So I know next year when I get courses, I know I'm going to go in for interiors, furniture, and textile, somehow put them together and come out with a very decent
pool. And the thing is, design is just not limited to making products. It's not just limited to making clothing. Design has a very big reach, even in the background. Even, I mean, engineering companies, advertising companies, all kinds of companies, they look for designers to help. If you want to fix up a brand, you go to a designer. And the designer will help you out with your software, with your website, with your brand identity.
They actually, I don't know, we had a particular meet a couple of months ago at the beginning of our year, where our dean said, oh, we have somebody coming, and I think she works for Infosys. I don't know what she does there, but she works for Infosys with design. So I think they have a lot of recreational projects as well.
Evan
does that.
Yeah, Evan
we
does
have
See, the thing
talk
is,
about Evan.
Design
Evan
is not just necessarily... It's solving problems, okay? Designers are generally problem solvers in the simplest possible way. And there are a lot of problems to be solved. And because of that, there's so much scope for designers in the future. It's just building up right now. But in the future, it's going to be as big a name. if you're a designer, you're going to be as big a name as an engineer or a doctor.
Yeah.
How much is technology a friend of yours and how much is it a friend?
Technology is beautiful. I think it's 100% a friend.
Yeah, our college is Srishti School of Art, Design and Technology. We don't have the name there because we have the name there because
the reason I'm asking is right, there are a lot of softwares available which can enable a pretty mediocre artist to produce something which
The mediocre artist, he needs practice time, and if he's employed in something else, he's really not going to have the time to do something as good as he could with a person who's completely in the field. I mean, and even the people in the field use the same softwares, except they have more time to work on it.
Simple example is, usually people draw a Wacom tablet on a Photoshop, technology you can play.
Yeah.
And a person, if you are to design something, you will be much comfortable designing on paper with a pen rather than a Wacom tablet with a Photoshop, right?
See, technology just makes our work like 10 times easier. I'm not somebody who uses technology, but I sit and I watch people who use technology and say, God, I wish, because I haven't learned it yet. It makes their work so much faster.
Not necessarily faster. The thing is, people, it's like a preference to people, okay? People might prefer to work with technology. People might prefer to work hands-on. I'm a hands-on person. I can't work with technology. Photoshop and all is fine, but it's not a career choice I would look forward to working at. I would prefer working with materials. I would prefer working with construction materials, maybe clay, maybe 3D models, something like that. And technology is a friend, but it doesn't necessarily have to play a huge role in what you're doing. So it's like just a component, if you get what I mean.
Technology that I have heard earlier has been like Microsoft Word doesn't make you a better writer.
Yeah.
No, it doesn't.
It's your skill set.
Yeah.
It helps you.
It helps. I mean, you don't have to write.
It could make you a cleaner writer, but it won't make you a better one.
Yeah.
So, you must have heard, like, a lot of street artists use the power of repetition to their advantage and get
the power of what's
repetition?
Oh, okay.
So, you must have heard of Space Invader, I'm sure.
Yes.
Right? So, do you guys have any Space Invader like plans, you know? Just to get Bangalore an element where, you know, you have these certain people who just walk by and not notice anything. But then if you notice, I notice this somewhere else also, and there's a repetition.
Yes.
Yeah, and you know, the city certainly
the thing is, if any of us did, we couldn't tell you.
Yeah. I did not notice. That's my point.
We have 5 more minutes left. So our course, I think, was modeled loosely on the Delhi Street Art Festival. You guys know about that?
No.
So, that's in Horse Course, I guess, there's a festival going on right now in which a lot of street artists from India and from abroad are working on the walls. They did the same way we are doing, as in they went and asked permission for the walls and they are painting on it now. So, it was us modeled on that. And I don't know, we are almost out of time, so I'm going to
I think
you
can take
Just go with it.
When it comes to making street art, it can be anything. For example, you make a clay sculpture, you just put some kind of glue on the back, take 20 sculptures, small ones, put glue, while walking just stick it on the wall. Just walk off, and you have put it on 20 places, and people are going to know, like, people who are walking on the road are going to be like, what is that? I mean, it is not something that's only for Van Heusen. It's all at McDonald's too. I mean, it's going to notice that. There's no name, but the main pleasure in street art is the fact they're going to see it. They don't know who did it, but it's there. They might even steal it because it's good.
Which is what happened to the plastic insulation of ours. Next morning,
it's unfortunate because once you're done with your piece,
it's not yours anymore.
It's the public's. So you have to give it away. It's just So
you have to alienate yourself from it. You will expect people spitting on it, people possibly drawing
people
over
it. It happens.
People who don't like it probably rewriting over it. They put posters, could be anything.
So it's not yours anymore.
Yeah, you do. Not necessary actually. Because, see, all you need, you have different types actually. Like we mentioned, we have posters, you can put up installations and murals. You have things called post-its. I mean, what is it called?
Which one? Wheat paste.
Wheat paste, yes. You take a bit of paper, and like how you put up posters usually with one sort of weird glue, it's very simple. You make that glue in your own kitchen. You can make it by the bucket and you still won't go broke.
A bucket of the glue will be 100 rupees.
There you go. And your printing cost will be negligible because you're using cheap paper that's going to stay on the wall. So it's not necessarily expensive. It just depends on the form you want to use to express it. If I were to use high quality paint and it's huge, yes, I'm going to blow 5 grand and regret the whole decision. But there are cheaper alternatives to it.
It is extremely expensive if you limit street art to if you limit street art to spray paint art. Because that is quite it's expensive.
Yeah,
but
a can over here is 150 bucks and that's not going to last even for
so that would, but if you want to take wall paint and work with something, you could do a huge mural for 500 rupees.
Yeah. That's not bad at all.
Yeah, if you talk about the whole poster thing, you develop your design, you make 250 Xerox copies, paste them around the area, you're done. It's not that, it's probably the cheapest form of art in the entire this thing.
I mean, that's how you usually have movie posters and stuff on the walls. It is repetition, yes. You're going to see it 100 times, and
it's going to stick with you.
You're never going to forget it. If it's a horror film, you know you're going to have that weird face recurring in your memory.
And compare that to you painting 10 different canvas paintings and getting a gallery to accept you, and then the curation charges and all that combined, and then you look at 250 rupees with 250 Xerox copies pasted all over the area. It's obviously connecting to more people than just about the 20, 30 people that come and visit your exhibition.
Yeah.
And it's 100,000 times cheaper.
Yeah.
Yes. About commissions of the wall, right?
Yeah.
So if you ask the person who's working, if there is say, you're not agreeing on a point, would you change it or something
the
thing
is,
not
come
able
to
find how desperately you want the wall.
Yeah,
we have
but some experience you could share, you have something over
it.
The water tank? No.
The water tank we already told them about.
Yeah.
See, the other day, I have a different course now, but the call for something similar. So I'd gone into this particular area which has a huge cloth market. Okay, but the cloth market is going to be a place with wholesalers, people who are renting the area. You have absolutely no idea where the landlords are. Okay, and they're just going to say Bangalore has Kannada speaking people, but this area was Tamil speaking. I'd brace myself for Kannada speaking people and try to get the lines right and all of that. But then everyone spoke Tamil, so I could understand what they said. I couldn't communicate back. And they said, I will ask my husband and call you back. They never called me back. So it depends on how persistent you are, how good your piece is.
And the thing is, when it came to us painting our murals, one thing we'd asked for was the fact that if you give us your wall, you're going to let us paint our piece. And if you don't like it, we'll cover it up with whitewash. But you have to give us that amount of time to let us finish our piece so we can at least document it.
Yeah.
So we had that condition. And if they didn't like it, on the off chance that they didn't like it, we would paint it with weatherproof distemper paint, which is great.
So
and it's free of cost.
Well, it's one very important thing, especially if you don't have a portfolio, is make sure you go to the internet and find some very
amazing,
obscure work that no one's going to recognize and show it to the person you're asking permission to, saying that's yours.
Also, you can do something similar.
Don't say it's yours.
You
can
say it. That's
we can do something similar.
Yeah, you could.
Everything I learned from you guys today is marketing, not art.
It's a part of it. It's a major part of it. If you don't market yourself, nobody's going to like you. So.
And street art is marketing.
See,
it is publication.
Is
that's what I thought.
Yeah.
Like, for example, I think there've been a couple of things cropping up around Bangalore, a lot of repetitive ones around MG. We were hanging around, we noticed them. We didn't know what they meant, but they were repetitive. It was
we could talk about, there's this spider, okay? It's a spider graffiti.
Oh, yes.
And it's all around Yelahanka. We don't know where it came from. It's a spider
with
an infinity sign for its pincers.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we don't know where it came from, but there are 15 to 20 all across the area, and it sticks with you.
You spot them at the most random times. I think the first time I spotted it was 7 in the evening behind some tree, and I was like, whoa. So... it does work. It is marketing.
Yeah, it is marketing. For example, there's the one of India's most famous graffiti artists. His name is Daku. Has anyone heard of him?
He was supposed to speak here, I think.
Yeah.
Okay, this
he
is
was nice.
No, this is not the Daku.
That's a different Daku.
Oh, not the same Daku?
Yeah.
No.
So I know this guy. I mean, I knew him like a year back. Because you see his work, even in Bangalore. I mean, Bangalore, Pune, Delhi, you see his name everywhere. You see the name Daku written everywhere similarly. So you know it's him, and he's, by writing that, he's marketing himself.
And he's like marked that locality, and you know that's where his work was. And before you know it, people will be like, hey, that was the wall that Daku was on. Take a
like
left
that.
From there.
You see
so
Daku's name all over Brigade
well.
Road.
That was in Bombay also. All these walls had fuck written
yeah.
in
yeah,
the
that was Daku.
Yeah,
that was
Daku.
So
that was Daku.
It's all over Bombay,
yeah.
In
yeah.
random places.
They
like
had
somewhere on the floor.
Yeah.
And people are talking about it.
Yeah.
You're talking about
marketing.
It.
Yeah, that's
yes.
Yeah.
They also had, they have, oh yes, we were talking about, since we're on Daku's topic, we were talking about things that are a little controversial, things that you wouldn't put out so openly. Daku had a whole line of work that said, stop staring, stop spitting, stop urinating, and a whole bunch of things like that.
Like, you know the, like, no trespassing boards? On those, he, like, again painted it green and then put stop spitting, stop bribing, like that. That kind of stuff.
So is there any, it is illegal, right? So any
that
sometimes.
Form is illegal.
Any rest of something controversial.
It is
have happened on
yeah.
some, can happen something like
yeah, for example, Daku, you won't see his face online. You don't know who he is. You just know the name Daku. You know his works.
Yeah.
You don't know a face.
We've searched. No face. At all.
If you find his face, obviously something's gone wrong and he's gone to jail.
And he
yeah.
is. Most street artists in India are not very controversial, but and he would be one of the few
most
controversial
ones.
And yeah, anonymity is key in that case.
What
especially
about
if
you're doing work in Malaysia.
In Malaysia, also.
I don't know what it is.
Okay, what does
also
it look
like? Also,
like
murals are the wall call ones.
Yeah.
In Delhi.
Yeah,
just watch it.
The one near Alsur, there was another group like from our college who did it.
No.
But the Malaysian, yeah. The Malaysian. That's also our seniors. What's the name?
Hendrix.
Hmm?
Hendrix.
Have you seen this work?
Yeah. Yeah, I know the artist. He was also part of the Delhi Street Art Festival.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I've not seen this one.
It's in Malaysia.
It's in Malaysia.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. We're done. So, any last minute questions?
Cool. Yes, one last question. Just going back to education. So, do you guys face any problems? Resistance from your parents?
Yeah.
Me personally, no.
Yeah, to some extent, but not mine.
No.
Mine only questions the fact that you're making a lot of pictures, but are you sure you know what you're doing? Apart from that,
and there also
a certain amount of trust.
Yeah, I mean, the thing was...
I failed a lot of classes just so I can take design later.
Yeah. I mean, you could probably be good at you could be good at drawing, but that doesn't necessarily make you a good designer. So taking up design was different.
Science
from
first,
out.
And then I went to commerce.
And also...
Then failed a few times in commerce.
Me personally, I didn't face any problems
on
because
purpose.
My parents are pretty open about everything. But I know a person, he, poor Daniel, yeah, he faced a lot of problems because his parents wanted him to do engineering and he wanted to do design very badly and he faced quite a few problems at home. So yeah, I mean, it depends on the societal pressures on a person. Yeah.
But you just need to find a way to convince them, tell them that it's not going to be so bad, show them how good you are.
And it's also getting pretty big right now, so it's not as bad as what as it was like 10 years ago, which is horrible.
It's not like you have no scope. Once you're out, somebody will need your help. So.
I think you guys are pretty entrepreneurial.
Thank you, hopefully.
Like originally, or I'm from Bombay.
I'm from Hyderabad.
I'm from Cochin.
So yeah, we're pretty.
So yeah, the center point of
Fox. Okay then.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Or you could just Google rabbit hole radical, you'll find a Facebook link.
Or you'll find Alison on the line.